Church. It's good to see everyone. Good to have you with us, especially those that might be visiting with us. We're just so happy to have you with us. And I want to remind everyone of the fellowship meal that will take place following services this morning. This is our fifth Sunday meal together, and so there's a lot of food prepared over there. A little later on in our service, we'll come to this table, and the Lord will meet us here. And the Lord will be with us over there, too. So I hope that you'll join us afterwards today for that time together in fellowship over there in the fellowship hall. A lot of other things are going on, taking place here. And so I hope you grab a handout and look on that inside cover there at some of the things that are going on, and certainly want you to participate in those. We need to be in serious prayer. Speaking to the Lord on behalf of Steve Snyder. Steve is in ICU in the Spring Hill Hospital with a kidney stone that has caused him to be septic, and he is battling for his life today. It's that serious, folks. And so if you pray, you need to pray for Steve today, and we lift him up. And ask the Lord to be with him and to heal him of this. And so I just want to make you aware of that today as we go through our day and our thoughts to be with Steve and the family as they go through this. Let's get ready to celebrate God and for the great God that he is. Let's be standing.
We praise thee, O God, for the Son of thy love, for Jesus who died and is now on above. Hallelujah, my glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, my glory. Bring life us again. We praise thee, O God, for the Spirit of life, who has shown us all.
Good morning. Today's scripture reading comes from 1 Chronicles chapter 29, verses 10 through 13. Praise be to you, Lord, the God of our father Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Yours, Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the majesty and the splendor. For everything in heaven and earth is yours. Yours, Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted as the head over all. Wealth and honor come from you. You are the ruler of all things. In your hands are strength and power to exalt and give strength to all. Now, our God, we give you thanks and praise your glorious name.
Amen.
Father, our God, we're so thankful for all that you are and all that you allow us to be. Father, we're here today to give you glory, to give you honor, to remember your Son, his love, and that he poured out his life's blood that we might have this opportunity. Father, we thank you for your Spirit, who provides comfort joy, and peace. And we pray this morning, Father, that you would be with all of us. Each of us individually have different concerns, different thoughts, different situations in our life. And we know, Father, that you're in ultimate control of all things. We praise you, we give you glory, we give you honor, because you are the one and only true and living God. And as we worship you today, Father, even before we ask, we know that you know our hearts, you know our needs, and you provide to us everything that we need. Maybe not in this life. This life is so short, Father. But we're blessed in this life. Beyond that, we're blessed to know your Son as our Savior, who gives us eternal life. And as we join around the table here in a minute, Father, help us to partake of that supper in a worthy manner. Father, not that any of us are worthy for your Son to die for us, but help us to understand the magnitude and the power of what you did for us when you sent your Son to die that we might live. Father, some of us have very heavy hearts. Some of us are suffering with loss. But we know, Father, it's all temporary. We pray for Steve Snyder. You would touch him. If it is your will, Father, heal him. He would be with his family. Help him to have the peace that only you can provide. Many others who are suffering physically have physical health issues that aren't good. We pray, Father, that you would touch their lives as well. But we're thankful, Father. We're thankful that this life is just a temporary thing, and that you loved us, have set your Son as a propitiation for us, for our sins, that we can be with you forever. Father, this day, as we worship you, continue to be with us. Lead us as we leave this place, that we might shine your light and show your love and tell others about the hope that we have, especially when difficulties come our way in this life. We know that you're there, and we know that we can endure all things through your Son, who gives us that strength. Father, we're so thankful for him. We pray that as we continue to live for him, you would use us to multiply. Father, multiply your kingdom. Let us follow him and multiply our faith. Guide us, Father, that we might be about your business in all that we say and do. It's in Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Who has the power?
Jesus, only Jesus. You know, we gather here each and every Sunday, and we do what we've been commanded to do by God, and that's to remember the sacrifice that Jesus made on our behalf. We fellowship with each other, and we gain strength from each other's presence. We hear and study the inspired word of God, and we sing songs of praise. I think being in the company of our Christian family is one of the most uplifting things that we can do. I think it builds us up where we've been torn down. It strengthens us where we're weak. It allows us to uplift others, but it also allows us to be uplifted. It allows the teachings of us as parents to be reinforced by the words and actions of others, which is very important because children don't always think parents know what's best. We're blessed to be surrounded by our Christian brothers and sisters, of course, but we also have jobs, families, friends, so we have an opportunity to share the gospel. Rick mentioned that growth is a goal for us in 2023. I think growth comes in many, many different forms. As we prepare to partake of the Lord's Supper, let's consider how we can grow and share the Lord with others. Some of the ways that we can grow, as children, we can grow as parents or grandparents, co-workers, aunts, uncles, nieces, nephews. Most importantly, as Christians, we have an opportunity every day to grow, and we can grow as a participating and active member of our church body here. Remembering the sacrifice that Jesus made on our behalf is much more than just partaking of the Lord's Supper once a week. We're commanded to share the good news. We read in Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 through 20. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." Let us strive to grow as Christians and also together as a church family. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you in the most humble way that we know how, thanking you so much for this great opportunity that we have to remember the ultimate sacrifice that you made on our behalf. We know, Lord, that the sacrifice should not be taken, or that it was not made in vain. Lord, we pray that we will do the things that we're commanded to do, and that we will remember the sacrifice and honor your name. We pray that as we partake of this bread, we do so in a manner pleasing in thy sight. In Christ's name, amen. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we again come to you thanking you for the fruit of the vine, which is a representation of your shed blood on the cross. We pray, Lord, again that as we do this, we remember the sacrifice and what it truly means, that it is something that allows us to have an opportunity to have a home with you in heaven, but that we are also commanded to lift up and share the word with others so that they may do the same. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. This concludes the Lord's Supper. The elders have set this time aside for us to give back a small portion of that which we have been so graciously blessed with. I pray that and think that as we are prepared to give back, that it is not a chore, but that it is a blessing and a gift. And may we consider that. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for so richly blessing us. We thank you, Lord, for our jobs, for our ability to take care of our families. We also thank you for the opportunities that you give us to bless others. We pray that as we give back at this time, that we do so willingly and cheerfully. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Psychology Today magazine And the title of the article was, Why We Need to Know Why. The article started like this. We are, all of us, meaning-seeking creatures. We seek not only to define the meaning of our lives by adapting, whether consciously or unconsciously, an overarching purpose, but also to understand the reasons almost everything that happens to each of us in the course of our day. Why? It's what drives not only everything we do, but also our emotional response to everything that happens to us. As I begin to reflect upon that, I begin to think that many times, most often in church, we spend a lot of focus and a lot of time on the what questions. And for whatever reason, we don't spend an equal amount of time on the why question. There could be a lot of reasons for that. I think sometimes the what questions are easier to answer. The why questions take a little bit more involvement. The what questions involve the hands and feet. What should I do? What am I supposed to perform? What can I do and what I cannot do? Now, if the what question is a hands and feet question, the why question is a heart question. And maybe that's another reason why we avoid them. But when you look at Scripture, you learn that Jesus cared more about our hearts than he did our hands and feet. That was his problem with the Pharisees. They were always concerned about what to do and what not to do, and not so much the heart. And you remember Jesus once offered 8 woes to the Pharisees because their focus was on their outward moral state instead of the inner moral state. Now the hands and feet can be doing the right things, but if it's doing it for the wrong reasons, that's not pleasing to God. Today we're going to look at the third of our directional markers that we're looking at surrounding our theme for this year of multiply. So far we've looked at going and growing. That as you go through life, you should be making more disciples, multiply. Last week we talked about growing and the need for us to grow spiritually and to grow more mature in Christ, to multiply. Today our focus is on as you gather, multiply. And again, I think the temptation is to only look at the what. What am I supposed to do when I gather? Opposed to the why question. Now the what question is certainly important. But our attention will be on the why. Why is it important that we gather? Now I want to do a quick timeout here. Because although primarily our focus this morning will be on the idea of gathering in a general assembly like this and gathering together for worship, but I want us to understand that any time that we're together with God's people, it's a big deal. We're going to leave here in a few minutes. We're going to go over, some of us, and we're going to enjoy a period of time together in food and fellowship. That's gathering. And that's important. But today our focus will be a little bit more on the idea of being together inside these walls as we worship God. To begin with, as we look at the life of Jesus, we notice something about him is that he often gathered for worship as well. In Luke 4, it says he came to Nazareth where he had been brought up, and as was his custom, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day and he stood up to read. You notice that phrase, as was his custom. The pattern of Jesus' life was to go to the synagogue on the Sabbath. Now, we talk a lot about the idea of us patterning our lives after Christ, that we're to look more and more like Jesus. And if that's the case, then it would make sense that we would want to make it our custom to do the same type of things that Jesus would do. We see that in early church. Those early followers continued the pattern of the life of Jesus in the idea of gathering. For instance, in Acts chapter 20, on the first day of the week when we were gathered together to break bread, Paul talked with them, intending to depart on the next day, and he prolonged his speech until midnight. It was the practice of the early church to assemble on the first day of the week to gather together to worship. There was a historian by the name of Justin Martyr who lived 100 years after the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. This is something from his writings. And on the day called Sunday, all who live in the cities and in the country gathered together in one place, and the memoirs of the apostles and the writings of the prophets are read as long as time permits. They were worried about the clock back then too. And then when the reader had ceased, the overseer verbally instructs and exhorts to the imitation of these good things. And then we all rise together and pray. Here's what those early followers understood. When we gather together, it's not just following a tradition. It's not just some ritual. We're actually gathering together and we are patterning our lives after something that Jesus did. Amen. And we're also understanding that God is gathering with us. We're doing what our brothers and sisters in Christ have done since the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. For over 2,000 years, God's family has gathered together in a place and on the first day of the week to celebrate that our Lord was willing to go to a cross and die for our sins, that he was buried in a borrowed tomb, that he went to hell and back for us, and that he rose again on the third day. And that's important. And that's a big deal. And when we gather each week, we're not just going through the motions. We're not just following some script that's printed on the back of a handout. We're not checking off church of our spiritual to-do list. We are gathered here to celebrate and to worship the God who saved us. You know, there was the question asked during the decision to shut everything down during the pandemic, whether or not that included churches. Ultimately, it did. And I'm not here to debate whether or not that was the right thing to do or not from a health standpoint. But I do believe that it raised some questions in the minds of individuals as to the importance of gathering. So for our time remaining, let's consider this important question. Why do we gather? And I promise I'll get multiply in here somewhere, okay? Why do we gather? Well, I think I've already offered a pretty good reason. But if you were to ask people that question, you would likely get a lot of different answers. Well, I go to church because I know that's what I need to do in order for God to be happy with me. That somehow we forget that God's view of us is not based upon our gathering, but rather our position in Christ. It's not like God's going to be happier with us if somehow we show up at church. That his view of me is based upon my position in Christ and not my place in a pew. And showing up at church every week doesn't earn us bonus points with God somehow. Other people might say, well, you know what? I go to church because that's how I was raised. Listen, if you have or had a parent that took you to church, you get on your knees and you thank God for them. My mother made sure that me and my sister was at church every time the doors were open. Now, I got to tell you something. I'll confess, I wasn't always happy about that. But I'm eternally grateful that she did that. Maybe somebody says, well, you know what? I go to church because of the emotional response that I get out of it, the pick-me-up that I get. And we certainly should be encouraged. We certainly should be edified. We should be lifted up. But we got to remember that church is not all about me. Look, there's a lot of reasons that people would offer us as to why we should go to church. Let me give you a couple that I think are real important. Number one, we gather because God is worthy of our worship. Are you glad you're saved? Are you glad that you are forgiven? Are you glad to know today that every sin in your past, present, and future is covered by the blood of Jesus Christ? Are you glad to know today that you are accepted by God by the work that Jesus Christ did on the cross? Are you glad to know today that you have eternal life and that your security in heaven is settled? Here's what I want you to know. That God that saved you, that God that forgave you, that God that accepted you, that God that reserved for you a place in heaven, that God is worthy of us coming together in a place to lift up his name and to worship him. And the key is this. Our response to who he is our expression of worship. We've done that already in our singing. Think about some of the words that we sang this morning. Great are you, Lord, worthy of praise, holy and true, great are you. For thou, O Lord, art high above all the earth. Thou art exalted far above all gods. All glory and praise for the God of all grace, who has bought us and sought us and guided our ways. And when you begin to read the book of Psalms, you soon realize that the psalmist understood the principle that worship is in a response to the greatness of God. For instance, in Psalm 95, we read this, O come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. Did you see it? It's to the Lord, to the rock, into his presence. It's to him. Why? Why is it all those things? For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In verse 7 he says, O come, let us worship and bow down, and let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. The Hebrew word for great is a word that meant and emphasizes importance, size, or significance. You pick any one of those three, and God is at the top. Webster defines great like this: remarkable in magnitude, degree, and effectiveness, markedly superior in character or quality. We don't gather because the church is great. We don't gather because the singing is great. We don't gather because the people are great. We don't gather because the preaching is great. We don't gather because the building is great. We gather because God is great. And when you look at Psalm 95, notice the descriptions that are there of the response to this great God. Twice he talks about being joyful. You ever see somebody come in church and they do this? And they start frowning? They look like they've been weaned on sourdough pickles? Look, I don't care how bad your week was. When you walk in here, you're saved, you're forgiven, and you're secure, and you have a joy that the world can't touch. I'm not saying we ought to start jumping over the pews. It is not a sin, though, to be joyful in church. Psalm 84 says, "How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, yes, faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and flesh sing for joy to the living God." As you gather, multiply your joy. And secondly, we see from Psalm 95 that worship should be a verb. I'm going to let that sink in a minute. It's not a noun. It's a verb. Robert Weber wrote a book by that same title, Worship is a Verb, and I love this quote from it. It says this: "Worship is not something done for us or to us, but by us." Worship's not an event you attend. It's not a video you watch at the house. It is an activity in which you participate. Worship is not a spectator sport. You don't get the privilege of coming in and just sitting and watching somebody else worship. We are all worshipers. As you gather, multiply your participation. And the third thing that we see here the psalmist talks about is that worship should be together. It's not something I have to think about. It's not something I need to pray about. It's something that's expected. Again, the psalmist in 149 says, "Praise the Lord, sing to the Lord a new song, his praise in the assembly," notice, "of the godly." Someone says, "Well, you know what? I can just worship God better by myself in the woods or at the lake." And God forbid that anyone deny you your private encounter with God. But if you don't come away from that private encounter with God with a greater zeal and focus of desire to want to worship and meet God with the faithful in the assembly, then maybe you're not encountering God at the lake. And answering the question why we gather, the first thing we need to understand is because God is worthy of our worship. As you gather, multiply. Secondly, God knew we needed worship. There's a verse in Hebrews chapter 10 that is our favorite verse on this subject. It's our go-to. The only problem I have with that is that too oftentimes we take that verse completely out of context and try to fit it into this pretext. Now, what I want to do today is to try to take that verse, set the context, and make an application to our question of why should I gather. Hebrews chapter 10, "And let us consider how to stir one another up to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together as it is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near." Now, the key to unpacking this verse is trying to figure out what day is the author talking about here. Some people would suggest he's talking about the Lord's Day, that we should encourage one another so much the more as we see Sunday approaching. Others might suggest that the day he's talking about here is the day of judgment, the day that Jesus will come back and judge all of mankind. And since judgment day is coming, we need to encourage each other to go to church. Now, both of those beliefs are worthy of our attention. I certainly think that we ought to be encouraging each other and lifting each other up about coming and being a part of what's going on each and every Lord's Day here as it approaches. And Judgment Day is coming. We're closer to it now than we've ever been. And so it certainly would behoove us to encourage each other to be a part of worshiping God, but the context of Hebrews is this. There are Christians who are wanting to abandon Christianity and go back to the old sacrificial system of worship under the law. And the warning is this: the Romans are coming. And when they get here, it's not going to be good. When that day happens, some of you are going to be killed. Some of you are going to be drug off into slavery. Some of you are going to flee to the mountains. So now is not the time to abandon gathering together. The day that he's referring to in the context here is the destruction of Jerusalem. And God knew with what was about to happen, what they were about to go through, what they were about to experience, now is not the time to stop gathering. So how does all that fit into our question? Church, when we look at the world that we live in today, as we see a world that is trending further and further away from God, multiply your worship. As the moral fibers of our society are being ripped apart and destroyed, multiply your worship. As evil invades and takes captive the thoughts of man, multiply your worship. Now is not the time to stop gathering. Psalm 73, the psalmist there was facing something in life. He was going through a very difficult situation, and he didn't understand why. You can put yourself in that place, can't you? When life comes down on us hard, and we don't understand why. Here's what he said. He said, but when I thought how to understand this, it seemed to me to be a wearisome task until I went to the sanctuary of God. God knew we needed worship. Worship is God's antidote to panic, his antidote to worry, his antidote to fear. Worship is God's antidote to whatever is happening in our life, whatever we're experiencing. When we're struggling with the why, now's not the time to not gather. And God knew that. As you gather, multiply. So we close this morning. Ask yourself the question, what possibly could it be that would keep me from worshiping God? There was a tourist in Washington, D.C. several years ago that called the church that at that time Franklin Roosevelt attended, the president. That morning, they spoke to the minister. And they said, I was wondering if you could tell us if the president was going to be there today. And here's how the minister answered. He said, I cannot say for sure that President Roosevelt will be in attendance today. But I am quite confident that God will be here, and we're hoping that he will attract a crowd. Why do we gather? And your answer is a big deal. If today you need Jesus in your life, for whatever reason, why? decide. Let's all stand and sing. There is beyond the edge of blue, a God concealed from human sight. He tends his cup to every you, every world's name is great might. There is a God, he is alive, and we live, and we survive. From the far God, created, he is our God, the way of heaven. There was a long time ago, a God who was taught to serve.
Let's bow as we're dismissed in prayer. Father, we're so grateful to have been here this morning in your presence to worship you, to be able to lift up songs of praise to you, and to be able to gather around this table and remember the sacrifice that was made and all of the things that we've done in order to worship you this morning. We pray that you will touch each and every one of our hearts, that every time we come together like this, that we will look forward to it, that we'll long for it, that we'll long for times to be together as your body, to be able to do these things, to let you know how much we appreciate all the great sacrifices and the great love that you've demonstrated towards us. Be with us this morning as we leave here and as we go over, particularly as we get to go over and eat. We ask that you would bless that food that we're about to eat to our bodies. We ask that you would allow us to always use our bodies in service to you and doing the things that you would have us to do. We ask that you would just help us as we leave here this morning, as we go out into the world, that our lights will shine, that people will look at us and see your Son living in us, that we will be more and more conformed to him, his image each and every day. We pray all these things through your Son's name, and all the church said, amen.